we're going to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Do you know that one of my favorite verses is that if thou shalt confess with the mouth of the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Those you have to believe that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. You have to believe in that miracle. It's a huge, huge, huge time for us. It's a big step of faith. How far away is heaven? One step is that step of faith into full belief in Jesus Christ, that if he came back from the dead, he's more than a man. He's the only one who ever came back from the dead. He's the only one that came down from heaven to be with us. But he's the only one that could, in his own power, come back from heaven. Now, that's a kind of a funny word, in his own power, because he came back in the power of the Father, but he also came back in his own power, because Father, Son, Holy Spirit are one essence of God. Now, Jesus Christ had humbled himself and was walking in the Father's power as he took on his omniscience and all the powers as he walked with us on this earth. We're going to go to Lazarus today because we're talking now about the last days of Jesus. The day, just days away, the cross. Days away, that's all. It's just days away. I want Austin to come, and I want him to read some scripture for us today out of John chapter 11. That's where we are. So let's all stand for a moment while Austin reads out of John chapter 11, verses 9 through 14. Brother Austin.
Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of this world. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth, because there is no light in him. These things said he, and after that he saith unto them, Our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go, that I may wake him out of his sleep. Then said the disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking the rest of sleep. Then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead."
Jesus, pray.
Dear God, thank you for us being able to gather to read your word and visit your word work in our hearts today. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, I pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. So there's the crux of it. Lazarus has died. He has died. Now, just going back to chapter 10 for a moment, in verse 27, it says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and I give unto them eternal life, and no man can take them from me. My Father, which is in heaven, is greater than all. No man can take them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one." Then the Jews took up stones to stone him. And Jesus said to them, "Make good work. What good works have I shown you from my Father? For which of these do you stone me?" Remember, Jesus did nothing but good. He healed. He preached. He taught them the way. He loved the people. What are you stoning me for? And the Jews answered and said, "For a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy, because thou, being a man, makest thyself God." Therein lies the crux. There it is. There it is. When I studied with the Jehovah's Witnesses, they used to ignore verses like these and not emphasize them. And tell you that Jesus Christ was just a man. You know? Michael the Archangel. Press a little bit. Jesus Christ is not Michael the Archangel. He's not just a prophet. Jesus Christ clearly teaches us in his word that he is the Son of God. That's why the high priest slapped him across the face when he was under trial. Slapped him and called him a blasphemer. Because Jesus Christ clearly teaches that he is the Son of God. Either he is the Son of God, Well, the scripture doesn't tell us the truth. Jesus was not telling us the truth. He is the Son of God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. It says in John 1:1 and verse 14 also. That's who Jesus Christ is. Now, days before the crucifixion, Jesus Christ is called upon by Mary and Martha. Lazarus, his friend, their brother, is dying. There's something to be very much concerned about, you know. And they're calling for Jesus to come, and come quickly because he's very close to death. Now the problem is that when the message gets to Jesus Christ, Lazarus is already dead. But that isn't a problem to Jesus. In fact, that is part of the Father's plan to give Jesus glory. Jesus can bring back from the dead. It's no problem at all. But Mary and Martha, of course, don't really understand that. Their brother is dead and Jesus is not coming. They think he didn't get there in time. Now, one thing we have to remember as believers is that when we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, that we're sealed in him. My sheep know me and I give to them eternal life, and no man can take them from me. In the Father's hand, no man can take them from my Father, which is in heaven. So Lazarus is in no danger here. He's already gone through. By the time Jesus gets the word, he's already gone through death. I'm talking to the men, Steve brought this up, and I just thought it was really, really funny. Maybe there was a conversation in heaven, Jesus, being omniscient, talking with him, saying, "Now, Lazarus, I'm going to send you back. Here you are, you're at the feast, but I'm going to send you back. It's important." And Lazarus saying, "Lord," looking around, you know, and enjoying that. "I don't want to go back. I'm really happy here, Lord. I'm really happy." And Jesus saying, "Yeah, but it's for the kingdom. It's so that others will hear of your resurrection. Know that I have the power. It's for my glorification. It's very important that you go back." You can just see Lazarus saying, "Okay, Jesus. Send me back." That's because he was in the better place. It's so wonderful to know that those who are in Christ, the best is yet to come. It's ahead. It's ahead for us. This world is full of pain, suffering, disease because of sin, death, loss. But the next is not like that. Filled with joy and happiness and fellowship with God forever. Who would want to leave there, you know? But Lazarus has the task of being sent back. And so that's what we see. He clearly tells us these things that he, our friend Lazarus sleeping. And then he goes on to say, because they didn't understand it, they think, well, that's good. He said, you know, it's good that he's sleeping. And he said, "Look, I'm telling you," Jesus said, "he's dead." You gotta tell them that. They never got it straight. They just never got it right. Now, the purpose of the story of Lazarus is to glorify God. It is to show Jesus' great love for us. It is to show how God is with us through a crisis like we're going through as a nation. God is with us. He has it all under control. We don't understand why, but he does. We need to put our full faith and trust in Jesus in times of crises like today. And then also, take charge of the opportunity. Tell your brothers and your sisters and your neighbors and your friends about the power of God and His love and care for us. This is a testimony. This is a witnessing time. When you go through trials, it's also a time to take that crisis and use it for God's purposes. So those people can grow. Other people around us. Perhaps there's a chance that the whole world will focus on God. Perhaps there's the fact that America has taken a day to pray, and not just doing medical things, not just closing countries, but as a nation to come together and pray. That's taking advantage of the crisis. And that's what Jesus is going to do with Lazarus. This is a situation where God is going to use it as Jesus Christ is approaching his own death on the cross. And he's going to show the power that he has, demonstrate the power that he has to have life over death. Remember Jairus' daughter? They had already seen Jesus Christ bring her back from the dead. Or the widow's son who was on the funeral pier, and Jesus Christ was passing the funeral and stopped the funeral and called back the son and gave him back to his mother alive. They'd already seen Jesus Christ bring back from the dead. He has the power over death, over life. He has the power over sickness. He has the power to give good health. He has the power to bring us through death to eternity and a better life in heaven with Him. We have to have full faith and trust in our Lord. That's what we do during times of crises. So let the world see how America, how American Christians, how the churches respond, how the Christian responds in the face of adversity. When Jesus got there, in verse 16, then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, you know, the doubter, and his fellow disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. They said to Jesus, Jesus, you can't go. They've already tried to stone you there. You can't go to Judea. And Jesus said, off we go. There's 12 hours of the day, and we need to use our time. I'm going to Judea. I've been called to the Lazarus side. So Thomas tells the others, well, if Jesus is going to go and he's going to die, then we're going to go and die with him. And they all will. The only one that will not die a violent death, of course, is John. And they'll be boiled in oil and come back and be put on the Isle of Patmos. But the rest will all be killed. Peter will be crucified upside down. Thomas, will be stabbed with spears in India. He's really being prophetic here as he says, well, if Jesus is going to go, we'll all go with him. And they all go to Judea. When Jesus gets there, of course, Lazarus now has been dead 4 days. Okay? 4 days. 4 days. He's buried. Dead and buried. Talking about from the human perspective, saying, did Jesus get here too late? I mean, he's already dead and buried. And Jesus arrives. And you know what? He was on time. God's timing is always perfect, but we don't always see it that way. You know, we called you and you came. But Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him in verse 20. And but Mary sat still in the house. So Mary is of Bethany. She's the one that anointed Christ's head. She loved him so much, and she sat at Christ's feet when he was speaking. She didn't want to leave. And Martha was the one who prepared the meal. Now I always get those two confused. You have to look at the two personalities. Each one of us, we respond to the crisis according to our personality as well as to our faith in God. Martha, you know, she was the one that could prepare the meal. She has great faith. But Jesus is, I mean, he's dead and buried, okay? And so she comes out to him and said, Martha, unto the Lord, Lord, if thou had been here, my brother had not died. You know? Wow. I mean, but according to his needs, he's on time. Now listen to the statement of faith that she gives. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it to thee. Wow. Martha shows her faith. That's why she was a worker. She was a worker bee, you know. She'd get out there and she'd work for the Lord. She had full faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And she said to her, thy brother shall rise again, you know. Now look at, when you stand over somebody's grave and the minister says to you, your pastor says to you, he'll rise again. Do you believe it?
Yeah.
You do? Yeah. Do you believe it? Now, when I stood over the grave and I tell you that person will rise again, I'm talking about future resurrection in heaven, right? Now Jesus here, he knows that Jesus, that Lazarus is already in heaven, but Jesus is talking about the here and now. You know, the here and now. He will rise again. I don't think at this point Martha understands it, because she's obviously been a student of Scripture, because she understands the Old Testament understanding of the afterlife. And she says, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection of the dead, the last day. Jesus is bringing the things of eternity, the things of heaven, and things of resurrection more into light. We learn more under Jesus than we ever learned out of the Old Testament, even though they're both true. And so she's telling the truth. And so Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection. Why did he say, I am the resurrection and the life? He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Mary, you're right. Our dead will rise again from the grave. If they know Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord, you will see them again. That's what Jesus is saying. That if thou shalt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, that's Jesus from the dead, so we also will rise from the dead. That's what he's saying, clear as a bell to Martha. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. And then he looks at Martha. And think about this. He's in the grave. He's been in the grave. Okay, they very quick there. He's been in the grave. And he says to Martha, believeth thou this? And I say to you, do you believe this? Do you believe that your departed loved ones will rise from the dead in Jesus Christ? Do you believe that you will see them again? Do you believe that to be absent from the body, as Paul said, is to be present with God? Lazarus is already in heaven with God. And God is, Jesus is, maybe that's the greatest miracle. He's called him back from heaven to earth to inhabit a dead, rotting corpse. The body is rotting in the grave. And Jesus calls the body, the soul of this man back. Do you believe this? I ask you, do you believe this? And she saith unto him, Yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. Faith. Faith brings peace to the heart. Faith. Faith brings joy in the face of adversity. Your departed ones, you'll see them again. You'll see them again. And one day, we too will be called back from the dead to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's what life is all about. That's what life is all about. To have eternal fellowship with God. To get our loved ones, encourage our loved ones also to have the same peace and joy that we have by having full faith and trust in the Savior. That's what Jesus is doing. He's approaching the cross himself and he's laying out the groundwork. You believe I can bring back the dead. Wow. And when she had said so, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly, saying, "The Master has come and calleth for these." As soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and came unto him. This is Mary now. Mary of Bethany, who anointed Christ because she loved him so much with oil. And she sat at his feet and just listened, enthralled with everything that he had to say. And she and Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in that place where she met Martha, where Martha met him. The Jews then, which were with her in the house, and accompanying her, when they saw Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out following, they followed her, saying, "She goeth unto the grave to weep there." When Mary, she came to Jesus, she saw him, she fell down at his feet where she loved to be. She loved to be at the foot of Jesus, saying, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews were also weeping, who had come with her, he groaned in his spirit and was troubled. My friend, Jesus Christ loves us. And when we pain, he pains. Even though we go through all these trials and tribulations in this world, be it known that Jesus Christ weeps with us and cares for us. And he reaches out and puts his arms about us. We may not see those invisible arms, but he's there for us. He loves us. And she said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said unto him, "Lord, come and see," as if he didn't know, you know? And then it says, Jesus wept. Jesus wept. Jesus wept. Now, I got in trouble in seminary with this one. I wrote a paper on this. And I told my professors that he wept because of the unbelief that he saw among the people in the crowd. I'm going to show you that in a little bit. And I got knocked down for it. The graduate students said, "No!" You know? "No, this was not the case. He was weeping because he loved the people, and that was, he was just overcome with the love." But I think yes, he was feeling that, but he also looked out and he looked at the crowd, and some had looked at Jesus Christ in full faith, and others looked at him in derision. "Look at him! He comes too late. The body's in the grave, rotting in the grave." And he wept. He wept. My friends, Jesus, the Bible says that if thou shalt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Now, that's directed at everybody. That means everyone who believes that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, everybody that puts full faith and trust in him, believe that he rose from the dead because he is the Son of God and has full power over death and life, you will be saved. But if you come up short, if you think he's just a good man or just a prophet, you come up short. And Jesus wept over the nation of Israel. He knows that he's going to die on the cross for all mankind, and not all of us are going to get there to heaven. He's come to bring grace, and it's for everyone. But not all will be under that covenant. And that's why when I was in seminary, I was convinced he wept over lost people. He was weeping. And I remember I went and complained to my professor. I think my professor gave me an A for the paper, and maybe that was the one that he gave me an A, and then the than the graduate student loaded to like a C minus or something because of that statement. So I appealed and he couldn't really appeal it, so he said, well, it wasn't typewriter. Something like that. You know? He couldn't fight it. But that's how so it was a big controversy, something I always remember. I think that Jesus weeps over lost people. And we should also have a tear in our heart for lost people. You know, I once preached this before in Jamaica. And we had a large crowd there. And I just thought that people were all outside, they're up on the wall. And I remember just the joy of imitating Jesus when Jesus came and said, Lazarus, come forth! You know, they danced on the wall, you know, they were just so wonderful. Jesus, come forth! You know, and of course, before that, Martha saying, he stinketh, you know, it's too late, he stinketh. You know, his body's already decayed, you know. Lazarus, come forth! And out of the grave comes Lazarus. Alive! Perfect! You unwrap him! Get the bandages off him! He's alive! Wow! The rejoicing, the happiness, the joy, and the dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and the face was bound about with a napkin, and Jesus unto him, loose him! And let it go. And so poor Lazarus leaves the great feast in heaven. And he walks out, and he's all wrapped up, face and all, and they unwrap him, and he's perfect. Wow. You would think that everybody, all the ones who would come with Mary and Martha, weeping and pleading with God and worshiping, would rejoice. But what does it say? Then many of the Jews which came to Mary and had seen the things which Jesus did believed on him. Praise God! And when I said that, I remember saying that in Jamaica and having people come forward, over 40 people coming forward to receive Jesus Christ as their Savior. Wonderful! Oh, how wonderful that was. Then, but some of them went their way to the Pharisees and told them what things Jesus had done. Then gathered they the chief priests and the Pharisees a council, and said, what do we do? For this man doeth miracles. If we let him thus alone, all men will believe on him, and the Romans shall come and take away both our place in our nation. Some of the spectators run to the enemies of Jesus and complain. And the enemies of Jesus say, this is all the more. Look, he just brought somebody back from the dead. We need to kill Lazarus and Jesus. Because every place Lazarus goes, the people are all going to say, there's the one that Jesus brought back from the dead. So both of these men are now in danger. And Jesus wept. And Jesus wept. Now, what is your response today? What about your children and your grandchildren? Tell them not to turn away, but to turn to Jesus, because he is our only way. He is our only hope. My friends, every one of us one day we'll stand the test. We're going to have to go through that trial. And your faith can't save your brother or your sister. Teach them. Pray for them. Encourage them to turn to Jesus. For he is the only way. Father in heaven, we thank you and praise you for this story, Lord. We turn to Jesus. We trust in Jesus. For he is the resurrection in the light, that if thou shalt confess with the mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Lord, when Lazarus was raised from the dead, some were saved. And some turned even more to the path that led to hell. Lord, keep us on the right path to heaven, the path that leads in Jesus the Savior. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.